Crowdsourcing actually has been used in a lot of research fields, and it hasn't made its way into speech pathology just yet. And so I teamed up with a few other researchers in speech pathology who've had experience with crowdsourcing to try to get the word out a little bit. So I became familiar with it in linguistics, but it's also used extensively in psychology. And the idea is you're doing a behavioral experiment. You want to get some sort of data like linguistic grammaticality judgments, or maybe you want to look at a priming kind of effect in psychology. And you have to recruit subjects. You have to bring them into your lab. You have to pay them. You have to go through the whole process. And it can be very challenging. It can be slow and laborious. It's labor intensive to bring a large number of participants into your laboratory. So someone in psychology said, "Wouldn't it be nice if I could put my experiment online and if I could recruit a lot of people online to do my behavioral experiment, my priming task, or to give me a linguistic judgment or a perceptual rating?" And in fact, there are established platforms for crowdsourcing. The one that I use, there are a few different ones. The one that's most commonly used in research is Amazon's crowdsourcing platform. And it has an interesting name. It's called Amazon's Mechanical Turk. So the original Mechanical Turk was a supposed chess-playing automaton in the late 1700s. It was claimed to be a robot that could play chess, that could defeat chess masters. But of course, at that time, the technology didn't exist for that. So it was later revealed that there was a human chess master hidden in the works of the machine who was operating it. And it looked like a robot, but it was actually a human controlling it secretly. And when Amazon developed its crowdsourcing platform, they called it Mechanical Turk because it acts like a computer interface. You, as the experimenter, feel like you're interacting with a computer and sending commands and getting your data processed by a computer, but there's actually human intelligence running the show behind the scenes. And they actually call it artificial intelligence. So it looks like a computer, but it's really humans doing it. So you can post a task on Mechanical Turk, and there's a huge population of individuals who work on Mechanical Turk, who will accept a job and will perform a task for you, and then you pay them usually a small increment of money for these tasks. And the tasks tend to be short, repetitive, simple things. And they're usually things that humans do better than computers, like maybe identifying objects in photographs or, in our case, rating speech sounds, things that you'd love to get humans to do, but you really want to have access to a large pool of individuals. I've been using it for speech data rating. So in my treatment research, I collect speech samples before, during, and after treatment, and I need to get them all rated by blinded listeners in order to tell whether my participants are making progress over the course of their treatment. And I've had challenges in terms of how long it takes, how hard it is to find expert raters, and how long it takes to get data rated by expert raters, and also how expensive it can be. And so I was wondering, would it be possible to get ratings from listeners on this crowdsourcing platform? And of course, I don't expect the average person on Amazon Mechanical Turk to have the level of expertise of a speech pathologist in terms of giving a perceptual judgment to a child's R sound. But the really interesting thing about crowdsourcing is you can take a non-expert and compare them to an expert, and at the individual level, the expert is definitely going to outperform the non-expert. But if you take a crowd of non-experts and aggregate across their responses, then that can actually converge with the type of response that you get from an expert because the noise cancels out. And it's what people describe as the wisdom of crowds. If you have enough non-expert judgments, it can actually perform like an expert's rating. So we were wondering, can we get a large number of naive listeners on Mechanical Turk to rate our stimuli and approximate the performance of our expert listeners? And in fact, I did a study using children's R sounds that compared a sample of expert listeners and a sample of a significantly larger sample of naive listeners recruited through Amazon Mechanical Turk. And we found that if we had a sample of at least 9 naive listeners from Mechanical Turk and we aggregated across their responses, then they converged with the normal standard that you would expect for publication in our literature. So it does seem to be possible to get ratings from these crowdsourcing platforms that are comparable to the ones that we would actually get from trained speech pathologists, which is pretty remarkable when you think about, you know, the fact that you're taking individuals who don't have particular expertise, knowledge of this task, but just by combining responses from a large number of individuals, then you get performance that exceeds what any one of those individuals could have contributed. I feel strongly, and also Suzanne Adloff and Michelle Moore, who were co-presenting with me, we have looked into the crowdsourcing literature in either linguistics or psychology, and we've really been struck by how well established it is there. It's just a tool in the toolbox if you're a behavioral psychologist or a linguist. If you need something rated, if you need someone to generate a pool of words that you might want to use as stimuli, one of the alternatives you'll think of is, well, why don't we put it on Mechanical Turk? And there's no reason that researchers in communication disorders can't benefit from it in exactly the same way, because many of the questions we're asking are precisely the same questions. So we just want to get the word out that this is another tool to consider that could really make our research faster and easier.